Welcome back to Notre Dame Day. If you're just joining us for the first time, welcome to hour number four of Notre Dame Day, a global celebration of the University of Notre Dame. If you've been tuning in since the beginning of our broadcast just a few hours ago, we promise you that this hour's broadcast will be filled with great stories from the university we all love so much. My name is Jack Nolan. If you're a fan of Notre Dame sports, you might know me from my work for Fighting Irish Digital Media, and some may know me as the voice of Notre Dame men's basketball. I'm joined here by my co-host for this hour, Abby Wellner from the class of 2005. Nice to see you again because you worked at WNDU when I was there.
I sure did. I was an intern. It's been a long time ago, and I love your own introduction. It's awfully modest. What is it? You're one of the longest tenured college basketball announcers in the country.
Yep. I just finished my 33rd year.
All right. Well, it is truly an honor to be sitting next to you.
Thank you so much, Abby. It's going
to
be fun.
Letting me sit. I'm so excited to join you and see what we've got going on here for Notre Dame Day.
Now, in case you were curious, we are here at the LaFortune Student Center on the Notre Dame campus, broadcasting from the ballroom on the second floor. This is just a few yards away from the famous Golden Dome. This will be our Notre Dame Day headquarters for the next 25 hours as we celebrate all things Notre Dame with students, parents, friends, and fans from all around the world.
And Jack, this year we have something really special going on. You guys, the viewers, all have a say in who gets an additional $1 million. I would love to be able to dictate where $1 million go. Every time you log on and donate, you have a chance to determine how that money will be distributed across the university.
That's right, Abby. The total votes cast during our Notre Dame Day broadcast for student clubs, residence hall, the academy, Fighting Irish Digital Media, I had to get that in, and other groups on campus will determine what percentage of the $1 million they will receive.
So the more votes you cast for your favorite academic unit, club, hall, team, or what is it, digital media?
Fighting Irish Digital Media.
My boss is very happy now. Yes, you have done your job.
Yes.
You get that bonus this year. The higher the percentage of the $1 million they will get.
Now, Abby, of course, we would be remiss if we didn't give a quick shout out to the donors who were kind enough to provide Notre Dame Day with this $1 million gift. It's pretty awesome.
It really is, Jack. And if you're making a gift during Notre Dame Day today, you can vote for the Notre Dame entity you'd like to receive part of the $1 million in challenge funds from student clubs to departments in the colleges, from residence halls to athletic teams. At the conclusion of Notre Dame Day, each participating entity will receive a portion of the challenge fund based on the percentage of the overall votes received. I had to read that carefully because I don't want to mess that up. So your $10 gift has the possibility to actually be a $100 gift. Nice to see dollars multiply like that. So please consider making a gift and voting for your favorite Notre Dame group.
Now, and with that $10 gift, you get five votes, not just one. Mm-hmm. You get five, and each additional gift, you get an additional vote. I mean, I've already voted. You know where my five votes went. Now, let's get right to the many great stories we have for you this hour. We're going to visit with Notre Dame football stars Golden Tate and from the current roster, Jerry Tillery. We'll visit with an NBA alum who has started a unique business. And we're also going to Hong Kong a little bit later in the hour. Abby will talk with a professor who is using nuclear physics to detect counterfeit art. So you'll want to stay tuned for those and much more. And we'll be right back after this brief commercial message.
Having served in the military for 32 years, I know that technological progress poses opportunities and challenges. Enhanced soldiers, ever-present surveillance, autonomous weapon systems. The question most often asked about these advancements is, can we? But an equally important question is, should we?
Robert Latiff is a retired Air Force Major General, a former weapons developer, and a professor teaching weapons ethics at the University of Notre Dame's Riley Center for Science, Technology, and Values.
There should probably be some
one of the goals of our work here at Notre Dame is to bring the moral and ethical implications of weapons technology to the forefront of our national dialogue, not only in Washington among our current leaders, but also in the classroom where we are educating future leaders.
It's been really great having a diverse class with peace studies majors and ROTC students and poli-sci majors, because consequences of these weapons technologies that I haven't thought about, they have, and it's really deepened our discussions in the classroom.
Now in its 28th year, Notre Dame's Riley Center is a recognized leader in promoting and examining the advancement of science and technology in the pursuit of the common good.
Notre Dame has been a vital collaborator with the Navy as we address some of the ethical challenges of emerging military technologies. Their scholars, including General Latif, are providing a unique voice in this important new field.
What I love about teaching at Notre Dame is that our students, who come from all walks of life, share the university's mission to be a force for good in the world, and I am honored to help them do that.
The University of Notre Dame asks, what would you fight for?
Fighting for the ethical use of technology.
We are the Fighting Irish.
The world needs a university that educates men and women who accept their responsibility to serve others. We will strive to build a community where education, inquiry, and faith combine to respond to the demands of justice. This is our goal. Let no one ever say that we dreamed too small.
Welcome back to Notre Dame Day. I'm Abby Wellner, and I'm joined here in the studio by 2013 MBA alum Conrad Billitz. Conrad founded a business called Framery, which manufactures interchangeable eyeglasses, allowing customers to have one set of lenses that can fit multiple looks. Conrad, thanks so much for being with us.
And thank
what
you so much.
A tremendous concept and nice specs you got there.
Well, thank you. I decided to go with the green ones, obviously, come back to campus.
Very nice. You know. Yeah, way to pull the team colors.
You got
to
do it.
So how was the concept born?
Yeah, well, it kind of traces back to an incident I had when I was younger. When I was 11, my best friend accidentally shot me in the eye with a BB gun, and since then I've had to wear glasses. And it never really made sense to me why they were made the way they are. I thought they could be made better and they could be more affordable for people. So we created a system. So basically, your lenses just snap right in and out of your frame.
I wish I'd had my prescription handy. I would have brought it with me and had myself six sets of glasses to go between.
There you go. That's the goal.
All right. And so your undergrad work was where?
I went to Boise State.
Okay. And what made you decide you wanted to be at Notre Dame for your MBA?
I mean, Notre Dame says you can go to school there, you go there, right?
Uh-huh.
That's sort of how it works.
Kind of the mentality I guess we all have. That's right.
And,
it picks
us. I grew up a big Notre Dame fan. My whole family, you know, we were all raised on the Fighting Irish, so it was awesome to be able to attend.
The blue and gold runs in the blood. It certainly
does.
For all
absolutely.
Of us, I guess. Yeah. And you recently received quite an honor. Tell me a little bit about what it was.
Yeah. In, January, I was named to Forbes' 30 Under 30 list. So very, very cool.
What was it like when you heard that you were going to be named to the list?
I was a little surprised. You know, there's obviously so many amazing entrepreneurs under 30. I was awarded it for manufacturing and industry, which is kind of cool because everything that everybody's doing now is so tech. It was a great honor, and it was really a testament to, you know, our awesome team above anything. So
when you've come so far in such a short amount of time, what do you have looking forward? What's down the road for Framery?
We're going to continue to release new collections. We're going to be making a push in the next 3 to 12 months to start to move into more retail and independent optical and things like that. So really having more access to our product for the customers that want it. And on Friday, it would have been past July, we filmed an episode of Shark Tank that airs this Friday at 9 Eastern.
What was that like?
I can't talk about it.
Oh, you
You'll
can't.
You have to watch the episode.
So I guess the Friday is the only scoop we get. All right.
Yeah,
so set the DVR Friday night.
Hopefully they don't make you look bad, but whatever.
Oh, terrific. Yeah. That's really exciting. And there are a bunch of kids out there who are trying to decide right now. We have several seniors that I've talked to today who are saying, I don't really have an idea what I'm going to do for my job. Maybe I should go get a graduate degree. What's your advice to folks who are looking at that possibility?
Yeah, I would say go and do it. It's a crazy trip. It's a lot of fun. Definitely use the resources on campus. Go and talk to Karen at the Jago Center every day. She was my best friend when I was at Notre Dame. So definitely use the resources that are here, but you only live once. You might as well go and do it and have fun.
That's a great attitude to have. Conrad, thanks so much.
Thank you.
And good luck
to
you in the future. You don't need the luck. You've obviously created your own.
Well, thank you so much.
Thanks for joining us. And we're going to send it over to Laura. She's at the Notre Dame Performance Area. Laura?
Thank you, Abby. It's my pleasure to introduce a performance from the Notre Dame Ballroom Club. I'm here with Club President Savannah Schmidt and members of the club. Savannah, tell me a little bit about the dance you're going to perform for us tonight.
So we're going to be performing a rumba and a cha-cha to Counting Stars, and we choreographed this piece for the PFresh performance, which just happened last weekend. And that's a fundraiser for the Project Fresh dance group, and a lot of different groups compete there. So we were lucky to come and get to show some of our dancing on stage for them.
All right, awesome. Take it away.
Lately, I've been losing sleep, dreaming about the things that we could be. But baby, I've been praying hard. Said no more counting dollars, we'll be counting stars. Yeah, we'll be counting stars.
Thanks, guys. That. Sorry, guys. Thanks. That was great. Stay tuned. We'll have an interview with Golden Tate right after this message.
Mick Barnes is a retired oil worker, a Korean War veteran, and a poet. He's been married to his wife, Alice, for 50 years. Mick is dying of emphysema, and his dream is to have one last family reunion where he can read his poetry to his children and grandchildren. They're spread out all over the country, and because they can't all afford to travel, he hasn't seen them in over 3 years. So what do we think, guys? Is this a dream we can make come true? Yes.
Notre Dame sophomore Caitlin Cromit is the founder of Dreamcatchers, a volunteer organization that works with hospice caregivers to fulfill the dreams of terminally ill patients. Caitlin started the program at the age of 15.
I started Dreamcatchers because I saw how all too often the elderly are overlooked by our society. These are the people who have shaped our communities and raised us. And I really believe that all of one's life, especially the end, is something to be cherished and celebrated.
Over the past year, Caitlin has expanded Dreamcatchers to 25 programs in 10 states through the support of Notre Dame's Hesburgh USCO Scholars Program, a merit-based scholarship that provides mentorship and resources to a group of visionary undergraduates.
What makes the Hesburgh USCO program distinctive is that we place a heavy emphasis on service. Our program is based on the core belief that each person can truly make a difference.
Okay, I call this my hometown. It's a little old town dependent on oil, acres of sagebrush on alkali soil. Quaint little houses, primarily.
It was really a night that I'll always remember. Always. Makes me feel truly blessed.
The University of Notre Dame asks, what would you fight for?
Fighting to develop great leaders.
We are the Fighting Irish.
Welcome back into the studio with me now. Here is Philippe Colon, Associate Professor of Physics here at Notre Dame. If you listened to Science Friday on NPR, you may have heard Philippe discussing his work detecting counterfeit art. Philippe, I'm sure a lot of people are wondering right now, how exactly do you do that? Explain.
So it's actually interesting. It's the techniques that you use and the nuclear physics techniques that you can use to detect small amounts of produced particles, of reactions, you can actually use to study art. There's an enormous amount of trace material that you can find anywhere, in art material and anywhere else, that can give you information on how old it is, on where something comes from. So what we can do is we can read that signal. It does, however, need art historians, artists, and things like that to then interpret it. But we can provide that sort of needle in the haystack technique.
Yeah, my sense is I've been to Europe a few times. You have a European background, grew up in Brussels.
Yes.
Art is so much a part of European society. Is that what drew you to this? How does a physicist get involved in detecting counterfeit art?
It's interesting. It's actually totally different from that. The technique I work in, which is called accelerated mass spectrometry, is actually used a lot in environmental science. Mm-hmm. And what I was really interested in is nuclear astrophysics. So what I really study is small or very unlikely reactions in stars. But the same techniques, again, can be used in art. And a colleague of mine, Michael Visscher, developed this new course that is called Physics, Methods in Art and Archaeology. And then I sort of joined into that. And the idea is really to sort of sell physics to those students that traditionally would hate physics. The traditional sort of response when you tell somebody that you're a physicist is, ooh, I didn't like that in school at all. And that's about the last conversation you've had with that person. And this is a sort of way of getting them interested. And that's how we got fascinated by it. It's because it's something that is very approachable and it's very relatable. People generally don't ask us about nuclear reactions, but they do ask about art.
What other things have you examined with a particle accelerator?
So what we do here mostly, so that's one thing I have to make very clear, is we actually don't do art authentication.
Okay.
Because that has legal ramifications that are so beyond anything we want to deal with. But what we really want to do is we want to train the students in those techniques, and we want to develop the techniques, push them on. And so what we've done is actually work together with the Snipe Museum of Art, with the Department of Anthropology. And they have done a lot of analysis of some of the materials that they have found, specifically anthropology, copper in local Indian settlements. And from the analysis of the copper, you can actually find out if it's copper of European origin or North American origin. So that can help them to sort of find out who local tribes were trading with, things like that. Analysis of Pueblo potteries, and specifically the pigments that they used, allow you actually to find out if these were actually painted in Colorado, and so you're going to get a lot of information from that. And so we've done most of that. Most of the work that we've done really is in collaboration with sort of local departments here on campus.
You know, there are so many CSI shows on television now. I'm seeing the roots of another possible television show now with the physicist who's an art detective.
Oh, absolutely. And it needs it more and more because, surprisingly, what I didn't know before we got into this is that art fraud is about the third largest amount of what you would call fraudulent money after guns, weapons, and drugs. Art is the third sort of largest purveyor of money to the criminal. So it's absolutely fantastic from that point of view. And so, yes, it is. Frauds get better and better, and so techniques have got to get better and better. And actually, if you look, the Louvre in Paris mm-hmm. actually has its own accelerator. It's called Aglaé, and they do 24 hours a day analyses of art just using these types of techniques. Here we use them more as a sort of teaching tool. We use them to work with students and departments, but they use it day to day.
This is fascinating. What we need to wrap up, but I have one final question for you. Do you have a favorite case that you have worked on or piece of art that you've worked on?
Not personally worked on, but one of the favorite cases, and obviously it's one that is always fascinating to talk about, is the Shroud of Turin that was actually radio.
You worked on it.
No, we didn't work on it. No. But three labs that I know very well, all three worked on this. There was one in Arizona, one in Zurich, and one in Oxford. And they used the exact same technique that I use to actually date the Shroud of Turin. And one can get into very long conversations about the Shroud of Turin. But it's one of the sort of fascinating sort of cases that has been looked at with these types of techniques.
It's been fascinating to meet you, Professor. And you have just proven to one and all that physics can be really, really cool.
I hope so.
I think you have. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Now let's go back to our Notre Dame Day reporter, Laura Thomas, who is in the performance area. Laura?
Thanks, Jack. I'm here with Halftime, Notre Dame's premier a cappella group, and Club Secretary Mary Catherine. What will you all be performing for us tonight?
Today we're doing Break Free, originally by Ariana Grande, with soloist Catherine.
All right, let's hear it, guys.
If you want it, take it. I should've said it before. Try to hide it, fake it. I can't pretend anymore. No, I only wanna die alive, never by the hands of a broken heart.
Thanks so much, guys. Now let's head back to Jack, who has Golden Tate on the line.
Welcome back. And on the phone right now, a gentleman you probably have heard of. His name is Golden Tate, Notre Dame All-American wide receiver, won the Biletnikoff Award. Then he went on to the NFL, won a Super Bowl title in 2013, then signed a pretty good contract with the Lions, and he had his best ever season this past season with the Lions, 99 receptions. That was sixth best in the NFL. He picked up 1,331 receiving yards, seventh best in the NFL, and he earned an invitation to the Pro Bowl. Golden, how are you?
I'm great. How you guys doing?
We're doing terrific, and thank you so much for taking time to chat with us. Tell me about this season, because you came off the high of winning a Super Bowl championship, and people always say, well, how can you leave a Super Bowl champion? But you got a terrific deal, really had no choice, and then you really excelled this year with the Lions. Obviously, the transition went well. Why do you think it went so well?
Well, you know, I mean, obviously, I don't want to leave Seattle at the time. I had to make a business decision to take care of my family first and foremost. I wanted to have a chance to send my children to college, you know, take care of my mother, my father, and my siblings. So I had to take that under consideration. It was a tough choice, but, you know, looking back, I don't have any regrets. I'm very, very happy with where I am right now in my career. I'm very happy with the Lions collectively, what we're doing right now and where we're heading. And, you know, I'm excited. I can't wait for another season this year. But, you know, it makes my job a little easier when you have Calvin Johnson on the other side. You know, you have Joe Lombardi coming from the Saints offense who, you know, air it out a lot. And Coach Call was a phenomenal coach also. So, you know, that decision took a lot of thinking, but I think I made the right one.
You know, I know Calvin was banged up at times this past year, and a lot of times in the NFL, you want to be the lead guy. You want to be the number one guy. With Calvin, at the very least, you're going to have to be 1A and 1B. How was your relationship?
Oh, I thought, you know, coming into the situation, I understood Calvin Johnson is the best ever, was one of the best ever played a game, and, you know, future Hall of Famer. So, I kind of knew my role, but I didn't come in with the mindset that I'm going to be number two. I kind of came in like, you know, it's going to be 1A and 1B, and so... you know, I just want to compliment him and help this team win games. But, you know, my relationship with Calvin is awesome. You know, he's a humble guy. I go to look to get advice from him, trying to get better, trying to get to his level. But, you know, I really like where we are right now.
I'm sure you've been reminded by the media up there in Detroit and by Lions fans. It's been 58 years since the Lions won an NFL championship. Do you believe that this team is heading in that direction where they can go and win a Super Bowl?
You know, I definitely do. And if I didn't think that, I wouldn't put myself in a situation to come here, because I want to win ball games also. So I think with Coach Caldwell, the personnel we have, the fan base we have, I think we definitely have what it takes to be, competing for a Super Bowl. You know, but we try to go one step at a time, own our division, try to get home games in the playoffs and go from there. But, I think we're heading the right direction. We just completed our first week of workouts, and it went awesome.
I want to take you back to, I think it was your first year in the NFL. I know it was the first time you've been back to Notre Dame for a football weekend, and you were nice enough to spend some time and come on the Notre Dame Football Radio Network pregame show with me. You had never tailgated before, and you were having a ball. What was that weekend like when you came back to Notre Dame for the first time not being a football player?
You know, it was a bit different. You know, it was something I had never experienced before, obviously, but, you know, wow, the tailgates are fun. I mean, I had a good time, a lot of nice people, some good food, and some tailgate raging. But I enjoyed it. You know, it was fun, and I definitely can't wait to get back out there again and tailgate and watch our boys get another W.
You know, I actually felt guilty pulling you away from the tailgating, but you're one of the few professional athletes who have come back, and after we've done your two segments, you objected to ending it and asked if you could stay more. I mean, you sensed how much the fan base here really, really loved you, because you got as good a reaction as any returning athlete we've ever had on that show.
Oh, you guys are making me blush. I can't wait to come back now. I'm a strong believer that without the fans and the supporters, I probably wouldn't be Golden Tate. So, you know, I definitely try to take advantage of that and show my appreciation to them, you know, little by little. You know, we definitely enjoyed, you know, the fans when I was there cheering all game long for us, and, you know, no matter what the weather was or what the score was. So, just a small way of me trying to get back a little bit.
Now, the guys that you played with here are gone. So do you still stay as connected to the program as you did the first few years that you were in the NFL?
There's a bunch of guys I still communicate with. Brian Smith, Armando Allen, Jimmy Claus is one of my best friends, Michael Floyd, Kyle Rudolph, obviously, and a couple more guys. But, you know, when I was in Seattle, I wanted to be involved, but to get to Notre Dame, it would be 4 hours on a plane and then another 3 hours to lose in day. So now that I'm in Detroit, I plan to get more involved and do some more things on campus.
Have you been able to follow the current Notre Dame team much, specifically the receivers? Are you familiar with the current Notre Dame receiving corps?
Just a little bit, not much. You know, usually I'm getting ready for my game on Saturday night, so I kind of start dialing in. But I've caught a few games, and you guys definitely have a lot of talent. And I believe you guys got some guys coming in too that's going to be able to help.
No, they got some great guys coming in, and again, I know you're really tied up. You must have seen Will Fuller a little bit just at the Annabelle Gold game. He caught a big touchdown pass, and guys are really having trouble covering him. If you have seen him, what are your thoughts?
You know, I actually have not had a chance to see him, but you know, I'll definitely be looking out this coming up season.
Golden, a pleasure to talk with you. I appreciate you taking the time on this Sunday night. And, you know, everybody around here, you're always welcome back. And they still talk about that time you jumped into the wrong band, but it provided one of the great moments in Notre Dame history.
That was on purpose, so it wasn't the wrong band.
I know that. There was a story. I read some stories today where there's very many different stories about it. So let's finish that. Talk about that when you jumped into the Michigan State band.
Well, I barely got in the end zone. It was like the corner of the end zone, and I saw this little girl playing like a clarinet. She had about 5'2", and I didn't want to run her over, so I figured I would jump and land on a group of people, but little did I know that the entire band scattered, and I fell on plastic chairs.
But you did a terrific job. You bounced right back up. And again, there's so many stories out there. I wanted you to be able to clarify yourself, because there was another story today that said, well, he didn't realize he was in the wrong band until later. And I knew that was incorrect. So thank you for setting the record straight. And again, we look forward to seeing you back here on your next off day this coming fall. Hopefully Notre Dame will be playing here at the same time that you're off.
Absolutely. And good luck this year.
All right, Golden. Thank you so much. Really a great personality and a guy that really loves Notre Dame to this day. Now, we want to thank very much Golden for taking some time to visit with us. And I think we are now going to go to Abby at the performance set. Abby, what do you have for us?
Hey, Jack, we have a great competition to come off the heels of that wonderful interview. Some good old-fashioned competition between the dorms here at Notre Dame, because it doesn't get any better than that. We have the Pascarillas East and West, and I've had these ladies remind me time and again which one they're from. West is closer to me. East is on the outside. Did I get it straight?
Yeah.
All right. Okay. Well, we know what dorm you're in. Now let's hear your names and what year you are in school before we get down to business. Okay? Who do we have here?
Hi, I'm Bree Prusikowski, and I'm the class of 2016.
I'm Maria Knoll, and I'm a sophomore.
I'm Abby Kirshner. I'm class of 2018.
And I'm Allison Dahl, and I'm class of 2016.
Class of 2018, you're making me feel old. All right, ladies, line it up. I think we're going east first. Is that right?
Yeah.
Okay, let's go.
Movie. Rudy?
Yeah.
My love of my life. Love of my life. Husband,
no.
Future husband.
Keenan?
No. Former quarterback.
Oh, Brady Quinn.
Yes. North Pond. Outside of the pond.
Kavanaugh?
No. It's a
oh,
memorial.
Oh, Stonehenge?
Yes. Wild women. On God Quad.
Walsh.
Yes. Football coach, 20s, used to box.
Oh, Newt Rockne.
Yes. The Steads event in Chicago.
Yacht dance?
Yes. Something that you did last summer.
Study abroad.
Yes. Otters, God Quad, men's storm.
Soren.
Yes. All right, time's up.
All right. Well, I could have explained the game, ladies, before we started, but alas, everyone knows what heads up is. You now have a good feel for the game. You're guessing Notre Dame trivia and who gets the higher score, which dorm. We have some pretty hard competition. PW, you ready?
Yeah. We're ready.
All right. Line it up. We have 7 is the number to beat.
Basketball coach.
Women's?
Men's. Sorry, that was my bad. Men's.
Flip it up.
Okay. Pass that one. We'll come back.
The dome. The other name.
Golden Dome. Home under the dome.
The whole thing.
The main building.
Yeah. The women's dorm on by the bookstore.
By the bookstore. McGlynn.
Nope. The new
Walsh
one.
Walsh fam.
The new one.
Ryan.
Yep. I just was there.
Bookstore basketball.
Yes. Where we eat always.
North Dunham.
Yes. The coach of the football team. Come on.
I don't know.
Okay, pass it. Okay. I don't know. Where you go after parietals.
Back to my...
No. It's still the same dorm.
24-hour space.
Yes. when the university was founded, do you know?
1942.
Or close?
1842.
No? Okay, flip it up. Okay. I was wrong. Okay, we're done.
Wow, some of these questions, I was a little nervous as to what the answers were going to be, the what you did last summer and where you go after parietals. I hope your parents aren't watching, or if they are, you cleared those answers ahead of time. All right, it looks like that round went to PE. You ladies switched spots on me, but congratulations to all of you. That was very intimidating competition. Very well done. 7-5 was our final score, and we're going to send it right back up to Jack.
All right, thank you very much, Abby, and I'm really pleased right now to be joined by freshman football sensation, Jerry Tillery. He's an 18-year-old student out of Evangel Christian Academy in Shreveport, Louisiana. Are you still 18?
I'm still 18.
He's still 18. It's amazing when you take a look at him. It really is amazing. He is arguably one of the top offensive lineman recruits this year, but he doesn't play offensive lineman anymore. He finished high school early. He arrived in South Bend in the dead of winter. And he's also a really smart guy, other than he came here in the dead of winter.
Right.
You're being from Louisiana, what was that like for you?
Yeah, it was pretty tough coming in, you know, about 100-degree difference in, you know, what I was used to at home and coming in here during the winter. It was quite the adjustment, you know, had to get new winter coats. I'd never worn long johns before. I preparing for the winter.
You know, the Bills, the Bears, the Packers. I mean, down the road, you're going to have to play in cold weather.
Right,
so you
right.
might as well get used to it
right.
now.
Yeah. I mean, it's easy to get used to. After about 2 or 3 weeks, you know, you just prepared, you know, just went on.
I'm sure you heard it that a number of the offensive coaches actually say they cried when they found out that Coach Kelly was switching you to defense. You won most of your accolades in high school on the offensive line, but I mean, I went back and checked when you got here.
Uh-huh.
You also dominated on the defensive line.
Right.
So when they came to you and said they wanted you to play D-line, what was your reaction?
Well, I mean, it's really something I wanted to do. I did well in high school on the defensive side of the ball. I figured it would, you know, transfer over to college, and it has. I've been really successful so far. You know, the little bit that I've played, I've met a lot of my goals. And, you know, it's just the skills translate. Like, I played offensive line, so I understand, you know, what to expect from a defensive lineman, and I can, you know, implement that, you know, to be successful.
You know, I've always had tremendous respect for offensive linemen because it's such a cerebral position. You have
right.
to do so many reads.
Right.
And you have to control your aggression. You actually have to let people hit
right.
you
right.
and not hit back.
Right.
But it's always seemed to me defensive line's more fun because basically the ball snapped and you get to go hit people, throw them out of the way, and tackle people.
Something like that. But, yeah, you definitely have your reads on defense. There's still, you know, reading and, understanding what the offensive lineman's doing in order to counter their moves with your own moves and counter their counter moves. So it's still a game of chess out there. So I've liked it. It's fun.
Now, your position coach, Keith Gilmore, says you are a one-mistake guy. You don't get rattled. What do you think he means by that?
Right, yeah. I mean, I can take coaching that thing. I think if I mess something up, coach will tell me, you know, you mess this up, and I know that, you know, they tell you how to do it right, and that's what you got to do is understand, you know, the correction and take correction. I feel like you have to be able to take correction as a football player in order to be great. So that's what I've tried to do.
You know, we always talk about the chemistry and the culture of offensive lines,
right?
But there's also one in the defensive line.
Oh yeah, for
Isaac
sure.
Rochelle says you fit in right from the beginning perfectly with the defensive line culture. Tell me how that went.
Yeah, I think that, you know, the dudes on the defensive line are a lot like me. So that really helped. And, I mean, coming in early, I got to understand, you know, get into the culture and, you know, see how they do things and definitely try to copy that, you know. So, you know, we're together all the time. So, of course, you have to pretty much like each other. So it's been fun. Yeah, the defensive line culture, I love it. Those are the dudes I'm with all the time, so it's a good time.
You know, I do Coach Kelly's TV and radio shows, and I know he doesn't throw praise out there easily. He has praised you
really
so much since you arrived here. So you don't pay attention to that stuff? You don't watch his press conferences
can't. You
and
can't.
Stuff?
Okay. Of course not. No, I'm not watching Coach's press conferences. Come on.
Well, they're on, you know, Watch ND.
Right. Yeah. I understand. You do some great work.
But see, people wonder.
Guy.
You don't pay any attention to labor.
No, you can't. You can't. If you're gonna be good, you know, during – I have too much going on to be sitting down watching press conferences.
So to hear that the head coach has singled you out as really being impressive, what does that mean to you?
Yeah, I mean, it means the world to me. You know, that's my goal is to come in, you know, impress these coaches so I can get on the field, you know, play football like I love to do. So that's what I came here trying to do, and I think I've done well.
So as we wrap this up, what are your expectations for the fall?
I want to win a national championship, Jack. You know,
that's why you come here, right?
Absolutely.
Jerry, it's our first sit down.
Thank you so much.
Really appreciate
Absolutely.
It.
Absolutely.
He is one smart young man. Thanks so much for joining us. Now let's go back to Abby.
Hey, Jack, thanks so much. We're back here in the Performance Center with the ladies of Howard on the outside and Pangborn on the inside, ready to play another game of Heads Up. Are you girls ready to go?
So ready.
All right. Well, before you get set up, we're going to get names and years. You're in school, if I can say it correctly. All right, and we'll start on the outside.
I'm Regina Engel, and I'm a junior.
Annie Batchelor, freshman.
I'm Molly McClure. I'm a freshman.
And I'm Kara Newman. I'm a junior. Oh, my God.
Well, the time just really does fly, doesn't it?
Going right fast.
It does. It does go by really fast. Enjoy every minute. I can tell you that. It does go by in a blink. So, Howard, you guys are going to get set up while I start to explain this game. So many of you have heard of the game Heads Up. It was popularized, as I remember it, on the Ellen Show. You're going to hold the iPad over your head. This is Notre Dame trivia. You will be holding the iPad. You will be guessing. Each of you gets, I believe it's 1 minute. I wasn't keeping time the last time, but somebody was, I promise. And whoever has the higher score after the minute wins. All right, you ready to roll? Okay, let's get started.
Oh, it's our favorite dining hall. South. It's across the lake, it's the men's dorm.
Carol.
Yep. There's one lake that's St. Mary's.
The other? Joe's?
Yeah. He founded the university.
Soren.
When you win Hall of the Year, you get this.
Dome Dance.
He recently died.
Hesburgh.
Yeah. They share a building, Stanford and?
Keenan.
Pass.
Did it go?
It has a quad, but then there's a huge building, class building.
D-Bart.
There's P-Dub and?
P-E. Pass Middle East.
Oh, he was fed soup by?
Joe Montana.
Yeah. Our brother dorm.
How? Fisher.
And time's up.
Wow, very well done, ladies. That's going to be a tough score to beat. I was trying to keep track. I think it was 10 or 11. We're going to leave you hanging on that one while the ladies from Pangborn get set up. And I may have misstated this. So she who is holding the iPad is the one who is guessing what is on the iPad. Well, this one over here gives the clues. Are you ladies ready to go? I think we're getting the game reset. I have to say, you kept your calm so well during that. I would have been panicked.
We practiced.
We practiced earlier today.
Sam practicing with different various categories on the actual Heads Up app, and then tried to create our own Notre Dame trivia.
Strategy and preparation. Impressive.
Howard really needs the money.
Howard does need the money.
Are you ladies prepared to fight with what has been a strategized game here?
We'll with our Wikipedia knowledge.
With your Wikipedia knowledge. All right, let's hope that Wikipedia knowledge is right. Okay, yeah. Ready? Let's go. We're going to count them down. Get ready. 3, 2, 1.
A lake.
St. Mary's Lake.
Yeah. It's a song. Oh, it's going to be too hard to skip it. The quad we live on.
South Quad.
Kind of creepy. they have a bad reputation. It's a dorm.
Zom.
Yeah. alumni has it. It's not Dylan's Moose Week. It's
Wake Week.
Yeah. Skip it. Skip it. Wreath. Dorm.
O'Neill.
Yeah. Duncan lives on it.
West Quad.
Yeah. The finest.
Farley.
Mm-hmm. Arts and Letters Hall.
Oshag.
Yeah. Football coach.
Brian Kelly.
No, let's just skip it. Oh, time's up.
Oh, time's up. But I think that the ladies over here from Howard actually get that money they worked so hard for. We're going to clear up the score, but we're going to send it over to Laura at St. Ed's in the meantime.
Thanks, Abby. We are live on location at St. Edward's Hall, the oldest men's residence hall here on campus, and I am in the dorm room of senior Mitch Abraham. Mitch, I understand that you recently released an album on SoundCloud and iTunes that you created mostly here in this room. How did you do that?
Well, yeah, I started it last summer, and I don't know. I essentially made two songs like at a different house off campus, but then the last two songs I made here. And yeah, I don't know. It was fun. I did everything. I couldn't find anybody else to do like the vocals or anything for me. So I had to do the drums, the guitars, the keyboards, and spent last year learning how to produce and mix and do all this stuff on Ableton Live, which is like the digital audio workstation or DAW that I use. So yeah, it's... No, it's been a lot of fun, though. Other than all the people who live around me who probably want to kill me for making too much noise, everybody seems to have liked it. And, yeah, my roommate's been awesome, too. He kind of got sucked into this, but he sort of knew what he was getting into as well. So,
awesome. Can you tell us a little bit about your song process? You know, how do you know when a song is ready? Are you kind of always working on your music?
Yeah, I mean, I try to get a lot of songs going. I mean, with the EP, I knew I had to get four songs, so I always get them to about 60% and then move on to the next one. And then I come back, and that's really what takes the longest is, like, finalizing it. And you kind of have to sit there and drive yourself crazy. And but it's a lot of fun. I mean, you just have to – it's tough when nobody's there to, like, pull the plug on you like a label would or whatnot. So you kind of have to sit there and finally just come to terms with it being, like, finished, which is nice, though. But – I don't know, it's a lot of fun to hear what everybody has to say about it, and all the guys around here seem to have liked it and whatnot, so it was fun, though.
And can we expect any new releases from you anytime soon?
Yeah, I'm moving out to LA, I got a place there, and I'm turning the basement of this place I got into a studio, and I'm finishing up the EP that I'm working on now, and hopefully after that, probably like a final, like full album, and then hopefully start touring after that as well. So we'll see. I don't know. It's going to be exciting. I have to figure out, because I don't have any bandmates, what I'm going to do for a live show, though. So we'll see.
Awesome. Well, do you want to play us a little something real quick?
Yeah, this is something that I've been working on recently. It's actually anybody who's in my music tech class tomorrow, you'll hear this as well. So.
Awesome. Thanks so much, Mitch, and good luck in your career.
Thank you.
Now let's head back to the social media lounge.
Thanks again. I'm Jonathan, joining you once again from the social media lounge here in the Fortune Student Center. A huge thank you to everyone that has participated in Notre Dame Day. We are so close to breaking that 6,000 gift mark. It's truly staggering, and the amount of votes behind that is just amazing. It's a huge effort by the Notre Dame family in just a few short hours, so a big thanks to everyone that's gotten out there. So let's take a look at the leaderboard. Specifically, let's look at the different academic areas that you can vote for with your $10 minimum gift here on Notre Dame Day. At the top, Sacred Music, you've heard me mention them before. They've had a huge showing so far, 759 votes. If the contest ended right now, they would have over $33,000, unbelievably. But some other areas, too, some dark horses in there. And it all goes to show that it's really anybody's game. It's all about getting the word out. It's about activating people that you know to go and advocate on your behalf for the areas that mean most to you. So, for instance, groups like Save the Skeletons, Army ROTC, Shakespeare at Notre Dame right now is 112 votes and would get almost $5,000 from our $1 million challenge fund if the contest ended right now. So it's literally anybody's game. There are hundreds of interests. If you haven't made a gift yet, click that that gold given vote button. You can text to give as well. That information is along the bottom of the screen. Get active, get involved. We're just getting started, but there's still plenty of room left to go. Now we'll take it to Mickey, who's going to tell you about some of the other things heading in the social media world. Mickey?
All right. Thank you, Jonathan. What an hour we had last hour. We had St. Ed's Hall. We had halftime. But one of the highlights was Jack Nolan's interview with Golden Tate, which was a great tie-in to our photo poll from last hour. Shockingly, I know to all of you, Golden Tate's deep dive into the band at the Michigan State game won the photo poll, 79%. And you guys all heard him speak about that short little clarinet player that he was hoping to dodge with that dive. So great interview with Golden there in that last hour. Our new photo poll for this hour, which is your favorite Brady Quinn game? The completion record, when he broke that against Michigan State, or when he broke the touchdown record against BYU? Vote for it this hour on NotreDameDay.nd.edu. Let's take a look at what's trending on social media now, particularly Twitter and Facebook. There's a lot of activity here. One of my favorite posts from this hour was for halftime, saying that with your votes, the halftime group is hoping to buy new microphones this year. That's an example of what Jonathan's talking about. Mobilize your team there, mobilize your fans, and let's get this going on social media. Again, another favorite, why not vote for Knott Hall? Get creative out there, get on Twitter, and let's mobilize and activate your team. All right, Jonathan, let's take it over here with one of our favorite people on campus, Matt Kishore, university photographer.
Matt, how you doing? I'm going to cross the front so I can get your microphone. Right. Matt, how you doing? Everybody knows Matt's work. It's all over the place. He's got a new project he's been working on. Matt, tell us about what you have here.
This is a poster that my office recently released. It's called Home Under the Dome. It's every dorm on campus currently. I know there's going to be two more in a year or so, but right now there's 30. And from alumni to Zom, A to Z, alumni first alphabetically, first in our hearts. Oh, did you live in Dillon? Sorry. Every door, it kind of tells a little story about when the building was built, and I like the fact that Keenan and Stanford kind of share a door there. Just something that I realized after some time of just wandering campus and shooting things that amused me, I kind of had a little collection going here, and I used the folks in our design department in the marketing communications office, put this together as a poster, and we thought it looked pretty cool.
Let me ask you, Matt, you are wildly talented, and many people would love to get their hands onto one of your photographs. This is a great opportunity to get a collection of many. How is one able to purchase this if they're interested?
This is available through our department website, photos.nd.edu. Four sizes, what I call small, medium, large, and large. This is the largest size, 24 by 36. It's not a poster, it's an actual photo print, so it's custom made to order. So there are four sizes, four prices, photos.nd.edu. It's right there on the front page. Visit the site.
How long did it take you to capture all of these?
You know, I can't really answer that. It's just one of those things where as I wander campus, I find things that just, oh, the Lewis Hall door looks nice. I'm on my way somewhere. I'll make a picture of that. As much as I hate to say it, the Dillon door is a nice looking door. So you make a picture of that. And then, you know, you just look back and you realize that maybe over the course of two or three years, you've gotten most of them, and you just, okay, well, I'll go and shoot a couple more to round out the collection. And it's not something that I set out and say, today I'm going to do this or that. It's just, it just sort of happens over time.
That's amazing. Thank you so much, Matt. I also just got word in my ear, we have passed the 6,000 gift threshold. So a huge thank you to everyone in the Notre Dame community. Go on NotreDameDay.nd.edu. Look at the pages. Look on social media for the stories that are being told. Every campus group, every area of interest has a story about what they would do with the money. So those are some of the most compelling reasons to vote for certain areas. I encourage all of you to check them out. See what's happening in things maybe you haven't connected with in years and years, a certain major, a certain campus group. They're doing amazing things today. They're doing amazing work on behalf of their clubs for Notre Dame Day. So make sure you get out there, get your friends and family involved. And we got a long way to go, right, Mickey?
We absolutely do. And we're looking forward at the top of the hour back at the live broadcast. Tune in, NotreDameDay.nd.edu.